comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 7. It is from page 42 in the New Testament. Let us listen for God's word. From there Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there, and could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syro-Phoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then Jesus said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon is gone. This is the word of the Lord. Please pray with me. Lord God, open my mouth that I may proclaim your praise. Silence in us any voice but your voice, so that in hearing we may be obedient to your will. We pray in the name of Christ. Amen. A couple weeks ago, the Indie Fringe Festival was in full swing downtown at a number of theaters. Like its name suggests, the Fringe Festival is meant to be edgy and provocative and even a little bit outrageous. There's actors and entertainers performing all kinds of acts, from musicals to comedy to vaudeville to deep drama. Most of these acts are not the kind of acts that you would see downstairs at our IPC theater, because the humor is a little raw, the costumes are a bit revealing, and the language is occasionally crude. Well, a couple years ago, actually last year, I went to a number of these shows, and a lot of them were excellent shows, and a lot of them were kind of rotten even, and I figured that's why they call it Fringe, because it balances the best and the worst of theater. Well, have you ever considered that your faith may be on the fringe? Because it probably is. Sometimes your faith plows through life with strength and grit, and it does everything faith is supposed to do. It holds you above the troubles of life. Other times, though, your faith is in a panic, and sometimes it drags you down like an anchor. So if your faith is on a roller coaster ride, going through the twists and the turns and the loop-de-loops of life, then probably your faith is on the fringe. But don't feel bad about that, because it is the same for most of us. Sometimes I think that Jesus came to the world just for people who hold a faith on the fringe. Because the 100% faithful people, they probably didn't need Jesus. They would stick to God, hold on to God, no matter what happened to them in life, like Job. Give him sores and sickness and pain and torture and his house burning down, and Job still believed in God. Job probably didn't need a savior like Jesus, because his faith was solid like a rock. And then there are people opposite Job, people who have no faith at all. Jesus' message is probably lost on them, unless Jesus did a kind of double backflip while curing cancer like walking on water, then they still probably wouldn't believe. They are truly the faithless ones. And so probably Jesus did not come for the truly faithful or the truly faithless. He probably came for the rest of us. The ones with the faith on the fringe. The ones who sometimes love Jesus for all the blessings that surround us. And sometimes criticize Jesus for totally ignoring us. That's most of us. We are the Christian majority who balances the best and the worst of God. And so for us, sometimes then, we run into a lesson like today, which is a real doozy. This is a scripture lesson on the fringe. First of all, Jesus is in a foreign land, surrounded by Gentiles. It's like Purdue Pete walking down the streets of Bloomington, showing up at Nick's at Bloomington. Probably was not wanted there. He probably shouldn't be there. He didn't fit in there. And that's where Jesus was, in this land of the Gentiles. And so one of those Gentiles, a woman, came up to him and told him that her daughter was very, very ill, and could Jesus do something? Well, there's two problems here. First, she was a Gentile, and Gentiles don't normally talk to the Jews. And the second problem was, she was a she. Strange women do not run up to strange men and talk to them. And so in that culture, there were two strikes against her. But even so, it's Jesus. It's Jesus. And so we expect Jesus to act like Jesus and treat the woman with respect and even love, and then go and cure the little girl. Yet, remember, this is a scripture on the fringe. And so what does Jesus do? Jesus surprises everyone by talking down to the woman. He says, "Hey woman, let the children be fed first, for it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." Did Jesus just call the woman a dog? This is Jesus we're talking about, not Donald Trump. So out of character is this quote from Jesus that it almost has to be accurate. This remark damages Jesus' character so much that Mark would have no incentive to put it in the gospel unless it was true. So Jesus must have said that. And it kind of puts Jesus on the fringe of life. But the woman was there, and she played along, though. If Jesus wanted to call her a dog, so be it, because she needed something from Jesus. She needed Jesus to cure her daughter. And so, like a dog on a bone, she chomped down, and she held on. She responded very boldly to Jesus. She said, "Sir, even the dogs under your table eat the children's crumbs." And we think to ourselves, my gosh, what a woman, what a mother. She knew what she needed and she went after her. Well, the whole brief conversation is like an act at the Indie Fringe Festival. It surprises us. It provokes us. It puts us on edge. Because so accustomed are we to the soft, centered words of Jesus that when we hear something different, we are taken aback and we think to ourselves, oh my gosh, how could Jesus have treated the woman like that? It must be a mistake. Oh, that Mark, he must have been drinking when he wrote the gospel. I can't tell my children that Jesus treated the woman so harshly. Well, boy, tell your children. Jesus was real. Tell them that Jesus experienced emotions and that sometimes he got aggravated with people. Every day he dealt with people whose faith was on the fringe. They wanted convincing. They wanted a sign that Jesus was real, and when things didn't go their way, they fizzled out. And then they went on to the next wannabe savior, and the next gimmick, and the next flash in the pan. So yes, believe it, Jesus called the woman a dog. Was it gracious? No. Was it loving? No. Was it on the fringe? You bet it was. Just like us. And so the revelation of today, the revelation of today is that our Savior, our Redeemer, our Prince of Peace, our Jesus Christ, is God on the fringe. God came to save people who are on the fringe of faith, people like us, and in order to do that, God had to walk on the fringe with us. And so what did Jesus do? Jesus engaged with people on the fringe, the poor and the outcast, the Gentile and the stranger, the women and the children. And he took on the people who were not on the fringe, the establishment, the Pharisees and the scribes, the rich and the powerful, the rule followers. He took them all on and he said, "You're no better than anyone else. God loves you. God welcomes all. So get used to it." The beauty of the scripture lesson today is that it meets the challenge of faith and it meets the challenge of life. It starts on the fringe where Jesus is, and then it ends on the fringe where we are. Because the scripture tells us that Jesus told the woman to go home, the child would be okay. Sure enough, she was, and all is well. That's what happens when Jesus meets the people on the fringe. After high school, I was a Presbyterian on the fringe. I didn't attend church much in college, but I did pray a lot. I prayed to get a good, decent grade in calculus. Actually, I prayed to pass calculus. I prayed for guidance in my life, and despite what some people may think, I never did pray for a victory in football. I didn't have to. Joe Montana was our quarterback then. So while on the fringe, my faith soared at times, and other times it plunged. Sometimes on the fringe, the Spirit of God filled me, and sometimes I felt like it ignored me. Sometimes I felt led by God, sometimes I felt pushed by God, other times I felt like I was in a tug of war with God. So you know, 35 plus years later, I feel the same way. My faith is still on the fringe, and honestly, I wouldn't have it any other way. Because you see, scripture like this tells me that I have a lot in common with God. We both live on the fringe. We both pull and tug on each other. We both experience the whole of life. We both claim the hope and the promise of the future. And sometimes we both call each other names. If Jesus could live on the fringe and still claim the kingdom of God, then so can I. So can you. And so let's do exactly that. Let's claim the kingdom of God. Whether we have the faith of Peter or the faith of Pinocchio. Like the woman in the lesson, Let's hold on to that faith like a dog holding on to a bone. And whether it shakes us to the left or shakes us to the right, let's hold on for dear life, because when the shaking is done, God is still there, which is the best thing that we can ever hope. A week ago Saturday, I officiated at a wedding of Andrew Hogg and Sarah Trent. And this wedding was literally a wedding on the fringe. It took place at Brown County State Park, beautiful setting, of course, but it was on a deck on the fringe of a hill looking out over the park. It was a beautiful scene. Everything was going perfect. But then panic ensued about 15 minutes before the wedding, when the best man realized that he had left the bride's ring back at the hotel. And the hotel was about 20 minutes away. They sent someone for the ring, but it was very clear that there was a good chance that he would not be back in time for the exchange of the rings. And so 15 minutes before the service started, the best man came up to me and he told me about the missing ring, and then he said to me something that no one has ever said to me before. I don't think any preacher has ever heard this. It was one of those edgy, provocative statements that I heard him say it, but still, I didn't think it was accurate. I didn't believe it. He said, "Bob, the ring may not make it in time. You may need to extend your holiday." It was music to my ears. Because when you live on the fringe, anything can happen. And it does. We are not alone on the fringe. God is with us. For better or worse, God is with us. And the kingdom is ours all the time to enjoy. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God.